My name is Naveen Reddy. In this video lecture, I would like to discuss job work under GST. As per section 2, subsection 68, job work means any treatment or process undertaken by a person and the goods belonging to another person. I have discussed this in schedule 2 of supply. Activities to be treated as supply of goods or supply of services. If any process is undertaken and goods belonging to another person, then it will be treated as supply of service. For example, X is transferring some goods to Y. For example, raw materials or packing materials. And Y is undertaking some process on this goods belonging to X. Then X will be called principal and Y will be called job worker. So, X is transferring goods to Y to undertake some process by Y. In this case, this transfer is not taxable. So, Y has to give an intimation showing the description of goods, name and address of the job worker, the Y can return the goods or he can send to another job worker for further processing. In this case, he has to mention details of another job worker also. He has to mention process or treatment undertaken by job worker also in the intimation, then it will be not taxable. Even if the goods are directly sent by the supplier to the premises of job worker without bringing it to the premises of principal, in this case also the principal can take input tax credit. For example, A is the supplier of raw material to X Limited. If A is directly sending the materials to job worker without bringing it to the premises of X, in this case also X can take input tax credit on goods sent by A Limited. For example, A Limited is sending goods worth of rupees 100 to job worker directly and GST is 5 rupees. X Limited can take this 5 rupees as input tax credit. Even if material are sent directly to job worker without bringing it to the premises of X Limited, he can take input tax credit and deemed supply of input. In case of inputs, they have to be returned within 1 year, and in case of capital goods, they have to be returned within 3 years from the date when they are sent out. Otherwise, they will be treated as deemed supply. And if the goods are directly sent by the supplier to the job worker without bringing it to the premises of principal, then this 1 year or 3 years have to be counted from the date when they are received by the job worker. If they are sent by the principal, they have to be counted from the date when they are sent out. And if the supplier is directly sending to job worker, this 1 year or 3 years have to be counted from the date when they are received by the job worker. You have to observe these small things in case of indirect taxation or direct taxation, because interpretation is very important for DT or IDT. This 1 year or 3 years have to be counted from the date of receipt of input goods or capital goods by the job worker if the goods are directly sent by the supplier. This period of 1 year or 3 years are not applicable to molds, jigs and fixtures or tools. So, in case of inputs, they have to be returned within 1 year, and in case of capital goods, they have to be returned within 3 years, and in case of molds, jigs and tools, this period is not applicable. And if they are directly sent by the supplier, they have to be counted from the date when they are received by the job worker. Otherwise, they have to be counted from the date when they are sent out. And clearance of waste or scrap. If the job worker is registered, it can be supplied directly from the place of business of job worker on payment of tax. If the job worker is not registered, it has to be cleared by the principal. Explanation to section 143. it is saying input includes intermediary goods also. So intermediary goods can also be cleared without payment of tax. As per explanation to section 143, input includes intermediary goods arriving out of process carried out by principal or job worker. So both inputs and intermediary products can be cleared by job worker without payment of tax. Job worker can also directly sell the goods without bringing it to the premises of principal. When the place of job worker is registered as additional place of business by the principal, but the principal cannot mention the place of job worker as additional place of business if job worker is already registered. If the job worker is already registered, then premises of job worker shall not be declared as additional place of business. Job worker can directly sell the goods without returning the goods to principal if principal mentions job worker's premises as additional place of business, and the principal is responsible for keeping account of these goods sent. For example, if 10 goods are sent to job worker and 6 are used in the process, so there will be balance 4 goods. This is done to ensure there is no diversion of material sent by the principal and they are used for the purpose of job work. And procedural aspects: the principal has to dispatch the goods by issuing a challan. In this case, it is not taxable and the principal is not issuing a invoice, so he has to issue a delivery challan in lieu of invoice. The principal has to dispatch the goods by issuing a challan. The challan shall contain the details of inputs or capital goods sent by principals, and inputs are capital goods directly sent by the supplier. The details of channels have to be mentioned in form GST ITC 4. All these challans have to be mentioned in GST ITC 4, and it has to be filed on or before 25th of the month succeeding the quarter. The details of challan have to be mentioned in form GST ITC 4, and GST ITC 4 has to be filed on or before 25th of the month succeeding the said quarter, or within such period as may be extended by the commissioner by way of notification. As per rule number 45, sub-rule 1, the challan should contain the details specified in rule 55 of CGST rules. Rule 55 is transportation of goods without invoice. So, you have to issue a delivery challan in lieu of invoice. Please pause the video and you download rule number 55 of CGST rules. Rule number 55, transportation of goods without invoice. Delivery challan shall be issued in triplicate. For example, X is consigner and Y is consignee. And he is sending the goods to a transporter. Then he has to issue delivery challan in triplicate. Original for consignee, duplicate for transporter, and triplicate for consignor. The delivery challan should be serially numbered, not exceeding 16 characters, and should be issued at the time of removal of goods in lieu of invoice. So, we have to issue a delivery challan in lieu of invoice. For example, if principal is transporting the goods, he has to issue a delivery challan in lieu of invoice. The delivery challan should contain the following details: date and number of delivery challan, name, address, and GST TIN of consignor and consignee if they are registered, harmonized system of nomenclature code and description of goods, quantity or provisional quantity where exact quantity is not known, taxable value, tax rate and tax amount, signature. So, this chapter is completed. I will do whatever I can do from my side, but you read after watching each video lecture and also forward this lecture to your friends, because if someone found my channel just before the exam, I can't help them. Also subscribe the channel. As promised, I will complete the GST lectures, but I will start next update only if it is successful. Thank you.